Good morning, one and all. Today's topic of PG activity is malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumors, routinely abbreviated as MPNST. Now, MPNSTs are tumors, malignant tumors that arise from the sheath of the nerve. The cells which contribute to the sheath of the nerve, these are the cells of origin of MPNST. MPNSTs are grouped under soft tissue tumors. Now, why MPNST has got a special interest in clinical as well as pathological settings? Because these tumors pose a diagnostic difficulty due to variable histological features as well as extensively variable clinical manifestations. That is why MPNSTs are the tumors of special interest. So for an instance, have a look at this slide or view of the slide. What do you find in this slide is highly cellular. Whatever tissue you are looking at is highly cellular. What are the cells? These cells are spindle-shaped cells, okay? And these spindle-shaped cells are tightly packed. Now, do you find any particular pattern of arrangement of these cells? These are arranged in a fascicular pattern. And do you find some of the mitotic figures over here? So in one high power field, you can find more than five mitotic figures, just like this one is there, then one more, then here one more, then here one more, and at the corner there is one more. So in one field you can find more than five mitotic figures. So these type of tumors are mitotically active. So these are the features you basically see in MPNSTs. So you can find any tumors, any tumor in your under your microscopy showing these features. These type of tumors can be labeled as MPNSTs. Now we'll have a layout, this type of layout in our today's presentation. In the first initial part of the presentation, we'll be dealing with some factual information about MPNSTs, and in later half of the presentation, we will study the evolution of the tumor, how it evolves from a scratch. To start with, what is the normal anatomy of the nerve? So this is the picture where you can find this nerve is, you know, has a covering which is labeled as epineurium. Under this epineurium, we have the fascicles of the nerve, and these fascicles are, each of these fascicles are covered by perineurium. Inside the perineurium, what we find are the axons of the nerve, and these axons are covered by endoneurium. Now, under the endoneurial cover, what we see is the myelination, that is myelin sheath, that is laid down by Schwann cells. This is how a normal histology of a peripheral nerve looks like. These are the fascicles of varying sizes, and these are covered by perineurium. Entire nerve is covered by epineurium. If we try to simplify further more, then we can draw a figure of a peripheral nerve, cross section of a peripheral nerve in this manner, where you can find epineurium is the outermost covering of a nerve. Inside it, fascicles are covered by perineurium, and inside the perineurium, we have the axons which are covered by myelin sheath that is laid down by Schwann cells. These are the nuclei of the Schwann cells, what are shown in this figure. What are Schwann cells? Schwann cells are a type of glial cells. So there are six types of glial cells in human body. Out of them, four glial cells we find in central nervous system, while two exist in a peripheral nervous system. Oligodendrocytes, microglial cells, ependymal cells, and astrocytes. These four glial cells, what we find in central nervous system, while Schwann cells and satellite cells, these two types of glial cells, they exist in the peripheral nervous system. Now, each of these glial cells, they have individual specific function. For example, if we take oligodendrocytes, they perform the function of myelination of axons in the central nervous system. Similar type of function of myelination is done by Schwann cells in peripheral nervous system. Microglial cells, they do exist in central nervous system and have a phagocytic function. Ependymal cells, as you all know, these are the linings of ventricles, and they contribute in secretion of cerebrospinal fluid. Astrocytes are the main cells which contribute in the formation of blood-brain barrier. Schwann cells are of importance because they are said to be precursor cells or the cells of origin of MPNSTs. Now, what is the difference between the myelination done by Schwann cells and myelination that is done by oligodendrocytes in central nervous system? First difference is Schwann cells, they do myelination of the peripheral nerves, while oligodendrocyte, they do myelination in the central nervous system. Now, if we see in this figure, the length of the axon is coated by myelin sheath, and individual Schwann cells, they lay myelin of certain length. So we need more number of myelin sheaths to cover the entire axon length for the purpose of myelination. But if we compare it to the central nervous system, one oligodendrocyte has dendritic processes and it covers the length of the axon. So number of oligodendrocytes that are needed for myelination in central nervous system are less as compared to Schwann cells in the periphery. One more clinical importance of this difference of myelination in by these two cells, the demyelinating diseases are more severe in central nervous system, as damage to single oligodendrocytes affects more length of the axon as compared to the Schwann cells. Peripheral nerve sheath tumors have been classified by WHO, not separately, but this classification has been included in the WHO classification of soft tissue tumors that is described originally in 2013, and the same has been mentioned in the recent Blue Book edition of WHO that is published as 5th edition of WHO book. So it has mentioned benign peripheral nerve sheath tumors as well as malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumors. Benign nerve sheath tumors have got schwannomas, neurofibromas, all its variants, the tumors like perineuriomas, hybrid nerve sheath tumors, ectopic meningiomas, while malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumors are classified like this. So the point to be noted here as WHO has not separately classified peripheral nerve sheath tumors, rather it has been included in the classification of soft tissue tumors. So what are MPNST? What book has mentioned is malignant tumors that are arising from either of these cells, Schwann cells, perineural cells, or fibroblast cells. Now what are these cells? These cells are the contributing cells in the formation of sheath of a nerve. That is why if the malignant tumor is seen arising from either of these cells, that tumor can be considered as MPNST. This is the first scenario which book has mentioned. Now, if in another scenario, malignant tumors are displaying the differentiation along the elements of the nerve sheath, and these are the only elements, Schwann cells, perineural cells, and fibroblasts. In both these scenarios, collectively, we can label that malignant tumor as MPNST. Understood? Okay, so we'll go further. So salient features of the MPNSTs, MPNSTs, as I told you, are the type of soft tissue tumors. Soft tissue tumors in themselves, they are very interesting because of their varied histological features. And in that, MPNST is also considered as elusive lesion because of extensive variability in the histopathological features. And this is why MPNSTs pose a diagnostic difficulty in the deficiency of standard diagnostic criteria and specific biomarkers. Since there are no specific biomarkers available as well as no standard diagnostic criteria have been laid down, that is why diagnosis of MPNST is very difficult. Then Enzinger has mentioned a sarcomatous tumor can be mentioned as MPNST in one of the three criteria. First criteria is if the tumor is seen arising from a peripheral nerve and the tumor does not show any aberrant or heterologous differentiation. If this criteria is met, then that sarcomatous tumor can be considered as MPNST. In the second criteria, Enzinger mentions, if a tumor is arising from pre-existing benign nerve sheath tumor, so your patient is already having a benign peripheral nerve sheath tumor and that has undergone a malignant transformation, in that scenario, we can label that sarcomatous tumor as MPNST. So what are these benign peripheral nerve sheath tumors that usually undergo malignant transformation? The tumors like neurofibromas, schwannomas. In third criteria, Enzinger has mentioned is if the tumor is displaying constellation of histological features that are typical of MPNST. So not a single histological feature is said to be typical of MPNST. Rather, we need to group the histological features together, and certain histological features can be said to be typical of MPNST. In any one of these criteria are met, then that sarcomatous tumor can be said to be as MPNST. So what are these histological features which are said to be typical of MPNST? First one is When we study the tumor under low power, what we see? Dense and hypodense vesicles, and they are arranged in a typical marble-like pattern. If we see under the microscope this type of feature where we see hypodense and hyperdense areas, they are arranged together, then it is mimicking a marble. So this is one histological feature that is said to be typical of MPNST. If the same tumor, if you go on high power, what we see? The asymmetrically tapered spindle cells with buckled or wavy nuclei under high power. So this is considered as second histological feature that is typical of MPNST. And third histological feature is immunohistochemical evidence of Schwann cell differentiation in the context of fibrosarcomatous appearing tumor. So your tumor need to be fibrosarcomatous in appearance, and if it is showing Schwann cell differentiation on ISC, then in these scenarios, the sarcomatous tumor can be said to be as MPNST. So what is Schwann cell differentiation? We need to know. So Schwann cell starts its differentiation from neural crest cells. So these are some of the markers that are attributed to neural crest cells. Then the neural crest cell differentiates into Schwann precursor cells. And these are certain immunohistochemical markers that are attributed to SPC or Schwann precursor cell. Then that Schwann precursor cells transform into immature Schwann cells and further into myelinating or non-myelinating Schwann cells. At every stage of these cells of differentiation, we see certain immunohistochemical markers like, you know, SOX10, S100, GFAP, then P75. Some of the markers you, for the time being, you keep in your mind. We will come across these markers in further slides. So if we consider MPNST's epidemiology, MPNST's are 3 to 5% of all soft tissue sarcomas, and 25 to 50% of the MPNST's, they occur in the settings of NF1 patients, neurofibromatosis 1 patients. Now, risk of developing MPNST in NF1 patient is 10%, but that risk extrapolates to 30% if the patient of NF1 is having plexiform neurofibromatosis. Half of the MPNST's we see as a sporadic or de novo, and remaining we see after therapeutic or occupational irradiation. MPNSTs are said to be disease of elderly because it has got a long latent period. So patient may be having a small lesion or a small swelling in his body, and it's over the time of several months or several years, the small lesion enlarges exponentially and transforms into MPNST. That is why this MPNST is said to be disease of elderly, as it is having long latent period. This is how we can graphically study the incidence of MPNST. Half of your circle has been occupied by NF1 associated MPNST, while almost half of the circle has been occupied by sporadic incidence, and remaining very few number of patients, they are said to be after radiation or due to unknown etiology. So with this pie chart, we can say that almost half of the patients of MPNSTs, they occur in NF1 settings. These are some of the clinical presentations of the MPNST. As you see, the limb of the patient, extremity of the patient is showing very big mass. This is one more presentation of a patient of MPNST. Here you can see a big swelling or big bulge on the side of the neck. This is another presentation where the MPNST can be seen in the neck, and it has already spread to parotid gland. This is one more presentation where we can see a bulge, big bulge in the axilla. And these, as you all know, these are the patients of neurofibromatosis. So these are the clinical presentations of MPNSTs. So MPNSTs, they present as big mass, enlarging masses. The tumors usually arise from the major nerves like sciatic nerve, plexuses, brachial plexuses, and other plexuses in the body. Most common anatomic sites are upper and lower extremities and trunk. Now, manifestation, clinical manifestations of the tumor, they vary according to the site involved. Lesions are noted several months before actual diagnosis is made. So I have gone through some of the YouTube videos of the patients where they narrate how the MPNST has been diagnosed in them. So initially, these lesions are very small sized and they are frequently misdiagnosed or underdiagnosed by the clinicians as lipomas or some other tumors or some other growth disorders lesions. But over the due course of time, these type of lesions have been seen transformed into MPNSTs. So these are some of the alarming signs where the lesion undergoes sudden increase in the size and intense pain, where we can consider as the lesion has undergone the malignant transformation. PET scan is also helpful in diagnosing malignant change in the swelling. Now, your patient has been diagnosed with MPNST by the clinicians. The tumor has been rejected and has sent to histopathology for confirmation of the diagnosis. So what do you find? What do you get is a large fusiform or globoid eccentric mass in a major nerve trunk. The tumors are usually pseudo-encapsulated. What do you mean by pseudo-encapsulated? The tumor has got a reaction, fibrous type of reaction, and that fibrous reaction encircles the tumor. These type of tumors are pseudo-encapsulated mass. Then thickened adjacent nerve segments indicate the spread of the tumor. So tumor is seen to be spreading along the axis of the nerve. And as I already told you, the tumor masses are very big sized, extending from 5 cm to very large masses. Now in NF1 patients, usually these type of tumors, they are deep seated and they present only with, you know, when they are compressing the adjacent structures. In that type of manifestations, we see the MPNSTs. Now when we get the specimen on cut section, what we see, the tumor is fleshy in appearance, opaque, white tan surface, and it is marked by areas of secondary hemorrhage and necrosis as we see in other malignant tumors. These are the gross findings of MPNST. So this is intra-op picture of the MPNST where you see this is a big mass, okay, and it is growing or it is seen along the length of the nerve. This is on cut section what we see. Fleshy, opaque, white tan surface marked by areas of hemorrhage and necrosis, and this is the pseudo-encapsulated mass. So this is the fibrous reaction which encircles the tumor and trying to limit the tumor. Okay, now on microscopy, what do you see? Under low power, you see hypocellular and hypercellular areas, and that is giving a marble-like appearance. So if you consider this picture, what do you see? This is a double tone picture. So there are two shades of blue color and one faint color of faint pink color. So this is giving a appearance of marble. If we compare with the actual picture of marble, then you will be able to appreciate the appearance of the low power view. Then in under the high power, what we see, these are the spindle shaped cells which are tightly packed and they are showing herringbone or storiform pattern. Now what is herringbone pattern? This is a fish, herring fish, and the bone or the pattern of the arrangement of the bone we can appreciate with the high power microscope. Under low power, what we see, tightly packed spindle shaped cells with variable amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm. And under high power, what we see, these spindle shaped cells have wavy or buckled nuclei. Now mitotic activity is usually seen more than 4 mitoses per high power field. Rarely nuclear palisading and areas of geographical necrosis are also seen in these type of tumors. What are other microscopic features we come across in MPNST? Perivascular accentuation of the tumor cells. So this is a blood vessel. This is the blood vessel, and around the blood vessels we see crowding or gathering of the tumor cells. So this is perivascular accentuation of tumor cells. This is one feature, microscopic feature, we usually come across in MPNST. Intraluminal vascular herniation of the tumor cells are also seen. So this is the blood vessel, and inside the blood vessel lumen we see that some of the tumor cells have already invaded. There are certain patterns that are seen in the MPNST, like geographical necrosis. So this is the large area of necrosis and this is our tumor tissue. So palisaded type of necrosis also we see. So this is a band of necrosis, and on the both sides of the band we see the tumor cells have been palisaded. MPNSTs are also seen in schwannomas. So where you can see this is the schwannomatous tumor where we see verruca bodies, and this tumor has transformed into MPNST in this part. MPNST shows perineural differentiation also. So what is the difference between classical MPNST and a perineural differentiation is, here you can see the cells with blunt ends. So these are like stick-like cells. So they are not showing any tapering ends. And they are not showing even buckled appearance also. So this is a perineural differentiation of MPNST. MPNSTs are seen in lobular pattern also. So these spindle-shaped cells, they are grouped together in the lobules. They are seen in whorled pattern and they are called as malignant perineuriomas. MPNST is showing divergent mesenchymal differentiation. So the tumor is seen arising from the Schwann cells, perineural cells and fibroblastic cells. So these type of cells, they show divergent mesenchymal differentiation when they are involved in MPNST. So MPNST with rhabdomyoblastic differentiation is labeled as malignant triton tumor, and these type of tumors are seen most of the times with NF1 patients. Glandular differentiation of MPNST, where you can see this is the tumor tissue, classical MPNST, and in between we can see the cells are arranged in glandular pattern. Schwannomas, when they transform into MPNST, they usually show epithelioid type of differentiation. So these are epithelioid MPNST. MPNSTs have been shown cartilaginous differentiation also. This is our classical MPNST and this part where we can see a cartilaginous differentiation. Malignant triton tumor. So MPNST with rhabdomyoblastic differentiation are said to be malignant triton tumors. These are rare variants. Usually they are seen in NF1 individuals. Loss of H3K27ME3 is particularly common. Now, what is this H3K27ME3? For the time being, you keep it in your mind. We will study this H3K27ME3, what it is in further slides. These malignant triton tumors, they are typically seen developing in fourth decade of life. Presence of scattered rhabdomyoblasts in the background of MPNST tumor tissue is the hallmark. So we see MPNST tumor tissue and in between we see these bizarre type of cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and pleomorphic nuclei. Desmin and myod1 and myogenin are extensively positive in ISC of malignant triton tumors. Why these are important tumors? Because these are aggressive tumors. Malignant triton tumors are aggressive tumors with poor survival. ISC in MPNST has got limited role. As I have already mentioned in the beginning of the presentation only, there are no specific biomarkers available to diagnose MPNST. That is why ISC has got limited role. So main use of ISC in context of MPNST is to differentiate MPNSTs from other morphologic mimickers, like other sarcomatous tumors. And in differentiating MPNST from them, these ISC is useful. Some of the markers like S100, they are used to differentiate MPNST from other sarcomatous tumors because S100 is considered as antigen for nerve sheath differentiation. SOX10 is another ISC marker that is used. CD34, CD57, P75, NTR, NAC. These are the tumors which have gained popularity over the time and they have lost their popularity over the time because none of them are seen to be effectively contributing to the diagnosis of MPNST. Nowadays, neurofibromin and H3K27ME3 are included in the panel of ISC for the narrowing down the diagnosis of the sarcomatous tumor to MPNST. But still, no specific marker or markers, they are useful in the diagnosis of MPNST. What are routine ISC panels or ISC markers that are used in context of MPNST? S100, I already mentioned, S100 shows focal positivity in some of the classical MPNSTs, but they are useful in epithelioid variants, and epithelioid MPNSTs are the transformation of schwannomatous tumor as MPNST. So schwannoma transforming into MPNST is labeled as epithelioid variant, and in that setting, in that context, this S100 is useful. CK and CEA are negative in classical MPNST, but they are seen positive in glandular variants. Desmin and myogenin, we have already seen in the setting of malignant triton tumors. CD34, HMB45, EMA, these ISC markers are negative in classical MPNST, but they are seen to be contributing in the diagnosis of some of the variants of MPNST. Now, staging of MPNST. AGCC has devised a system for the staging of soft tissue sarcoma. So that can be used in staging of MPNST. There are four stages, and these are criteria what are used for staging MPNST: size, depth, grade, and metastasis. So stage one is tumor of any size, tumor of any depth, but low grade with no metastasis. That can be said as stage one. In stage two, tumor is less than 5 cm in size, of any depth, superficial depth, high grade, and no metastasis, or tumor of more than 5 cm size with superficial depth, high grade. That is stage two. Stage three is tumor of more than 5 cm, involving deep layers of the tissue, high grade, and no metastasis. Stage four, if the tumor is seen already metastasized with any of the other criteria. So that is stage four. Differential diagnosis of MPNST. So there are many strong contenders of soft tissue sarcomatous tumors in the diagnosis of MPNST. So first is cellular schwannoma. Cellular schwannoma is uniformly hypercellular. Majority of the area is showing Antony A. But MPNSTs are considered as hypercellular tumors. Mitotic figures, even though cellular schwannoma is showing more mitosis as compared to classical schwannomas, but still the mitotic figures are less than 4 per 10 hyperfield. Whereas MPNST is highly aggressive tumor with high mitotic figures. So you can see more than 10 mitotic figures per 10 hyperfield. And schwannomas are encapsulated while MPNSTs are pseudo-encapsulated. Next contender is infantile or adult fibrosarcomas, where you see these type of translocations in fibrosarcomas. Such type of translocations that are not seen in MPNST. These are some of the points with which we can differentiate MPNST from synovial sarcomas with translocation X18. The nuclei in the synovial sarcoma, they are plump and stubby. And TLE1 positivity is seen in 97% of the synovial sarcomas, where these type of markers, they are not seen in MPNST. Leiomyosarcoma also at times it mimics MPNST. In leiomyosarcoma, what we find the nuclei with blunt ends, and S100 is negative, and smooth muscle markers are seen positive. How to manage MPNST? So such a big tumors, we need to give perioperative chemo or radiation, and with help of neoadjuvant chemotherapy and radiation, we can make the tumor operable by reducing the size, and surgical resection is the mainstay of the treatment. Now, what we can achieve with chemotherapy and radiation is we can shrink the tumor, and we can take care of micrometastatic disease of the MPNST also. So in this way, neoadjuvant chemotherapy with surgery, we can improve the prognosis in patients of MPNST. What is prognosis of MPNST? With the help of staging, we can prognosticate MPNSTs, but MPNSTs are usually aggressive tumors with poor survival outcome. They have got high rates of local recurrence. So even though we surgically reject the tumor, there are more chances of tumor recurrence. Poor prognosis, particularly if the tumor is seen to be located near the head and neck. If the patients of NF1, they are showing MPNST, in those cases also there is poor prognosis. Worst prognosis in cases of the tumors if they have already metastasized at the time of diagnosis. Neurofibromatosis 1, it is very important to study neurofibromatosis 1 in the discussion of MPNST, as we have seen in the pie chart of the incidence of the MPNST. 50% of the cases of MPNST, they are seen in the setting of neurofibromatosis 1. So these are the clinical features with which we can diagnose the patients of MPNST. I will not go into the details of this, but caffeole spots, iris lesions, nodules, skin fold fricklings, these are some of the hallmarks of the NF1 with which we can segregate those type of patients from our general population. So what is neurofibromatosis 1? It is an autosomal dominant disorder, and in NF1 patients, there is inactivation of NF1 gene, and NF1 gene is responsible for the synthesis of protein neurofibromin. Okay, so in the absence of neurofibromin, what happens? Neurofibromin is a negative regulator of RAS signaling pathway. So when the NF1 gene undergoes mutation, neurofibromin cannot be synthesized, and in the absence of neurofibromin, the cell undergoes unrestricted or unregulated proliferation. So we see a life-threatening complication of NF1 as MPNST. And mutations in NF1 are found in almost 90%. Some of the diagnostic criteria of NF1, neurofibromatosis 1. Now this slide is very important. Neoplastic predispositions in NF1. So neurofibromatosis 1 patients, they have 60% lifetime risk of developing various cancers like glioblastomas, paragangliomas, pheochromocytomas, breast cancers, GISTs, MPNST. So these type of dreaded malignancies that are frequently seen in neurofibromatosis 1 patients. So neurofibromatosis 1 patients need to be under close vigilance for the evolution of such type of tumors, and MPNST is one of them. Now in the next point, if you see, there is risk of developing malignant glioblastoma 40-fold more as compared to general population. But if we go down to MPNST, risk of developing MPNST in NF1 patient is 1,000-fold higher than the general population. And this is the reason these NF1 patients need to be closely observed for the evolution of MPNST. Now, there are some other tumors also we see in NF1 patients, like dermal neurofibromas. Dermal neurofibromas are the, you know, clearly visible on the external surface of the body of the NF1 patients. With their appearance only, we diagnose easily NF1, neurofibromatosis 1. But there are certain other tumors like plexiform neurofibroma and atypical neurofibromas, which are evolving in these type of patients. And these two tumors are considered as precursor lesions of MPNST. So there are more chances of transformation of plexiform neurofibroma and atypical neurofibroma into MPNST. That is why they are considered as precursor lesions. P16 is the tumor suppressor gene, as you all know, and loss of P16 is seen in atypical neurofibromatosis patients, and ANF, like atypical neurofibroma and MPNST, both exhibit additional tumor suppressor genes loss beyond NF1, like CDKN2A and SUS12, to transform into malignancy. And 75% of the MPNST patients, they show deletion of P16. Precursor lesions of MPNST. We have already seen PN, that is plexiform neurofibroma, and atypical neurofibromas. These are precursor lesions of MPNST. This is an extensive neurofibromatosis 1 patient, where we can see on the body of the patient, there are number of dermal neurofibromas. And the next picture is, this picture is of plexiform neurofibromas. Now, if we reject the plexiform neurofibroma, what the specimen we get is this type of specimen. And if we try to palpate, we get the feeling of bag of worms. So why we get feeling of bag of worms? Because of enlarged nerve fascicles. And why these nerve fascicles give the bag of worm appearance? Because they are rich in mucopolysaccharides. So these mucopolysaccharides are jelly-like structures. If we try to compress these type of tumors, we get a bag of worm filling. One more characteristic finding in plexiform neurofibroma under high power, what we see is the shredded collagen, shredded type of collagen. These are some of the topographical rearrangement of collagen and tumor cells, which give pseudomesenterian corpuscle and onion bulbs of Schwann cell. These are mentioned in the book. What are atypical neurofibromas? Atypical neurofibromas are pathologically defined lesions. These are not clinically defined lesions. So we pathologists, we define these type of lesions in the setting of NF1. Now, what are atypical neurofibromas? This type of microscopic findings, if we get, what are these? Increased variable cellularity, cytological atypia. So here you can see increased cellularity, cytological atypia. Here you can see the fascicular arrangement in these two slides. So these type of features, if we get, then those tumors are said to be a typical neurofibromas. But how they are different from MPNST? Like MPNST also shows fascicular pattern, increased cellularity and cytological atypia. Then why these tumors are not MPNST? So there is a limiting line. What these type of features, they are not seen in a widespread area. Like atypia and fascicular growth is not widespread in atypical neurofibromas. Mitotic activity and necrosis is also not widespread in these type of tumors, which are commonly seen in MPNST. So on this ground, we can differentiate atypical neurofibromas from MPNST. Molecular basis of pathogenesis of MPNST. So how these MPNSTs evolve from a scratch. In this slide, we can see there are peripheral nerve sheath tumors, not only MPNST, but peripheral nerve sheath tumors, how they evolve. So these are the genes which undergo mutations, and under the influence of loss of function of these genes, we lack these type of proteins, and in the absence of these proteins, the benign and malignant tumors, they evolve. So for example, if you take NF1, loss of function of NF1 leads to absence of neurofibromin protein synthesis, and the tumor evolves like from neurofibroma, it transforms with further loss of CDKN2A into atypical neurofibromas. With further loss of some of the markers, it transforms into MPNST. Similar with schwannoma. So in the absence of Merlin protein, the tumor we find is schwannoma. And this is MMNST, that is malignant melanotic nerve sheath tumor. This slide is also very important to understand how MPNST evolves from a scratch. So this is the sheath of peripheral nerve in which what the cells we see are the Schwann cells, fibroblasts, mast cells and macrophages. And all these tumors have already lost one allele of NF1. Okay, so these are seen in neurofibromatosis 1 patients. Now with loss of another allele of NF1, these Schwann cells, this one aberrant cells, what we see is the cell, Schwann cell, which has already lost both the alleles of NF1. So other cells, they try to surround this abnormal cell, and this is plexiform neurofibroma. So this is why this is called as plexiform neurofibroma. It has got heterologous combination of the cells. That is why this is plexiform neurofibroma. If we consider 100 patients of NF1, 50% of the patients, they undergo the transformation into such type of tumors like plexiform neurofibroma. Now these plexiform neurofibroma, when they lose some other markers like CDKN2A, P53, SUS12 and EED, these plexiform neurofibromas, they transform into MPNST. So you can see one aberrant cell has proliferated into a big mass and the tumor has been grown. So these tumors are MPNST. So out of 100 patients, there is a risk of 10% of the tumors undergoing transformation into MPNST. If we try to simplify, this is the Schwann cell which has lost one allele of NF1. With additional loss of NF1 allele, it transforms into plexiform neurofibroma. With additional loss of CDKN2A, it transforms into atypical neurofibromas. With loss of PRC2 further, it transforms into MPNST and further metastatic MPNST. Over the course of the transformation, as you see S100, which is the marker of nerve sheath differentiation, it loses. So as the cells transform one by one into MPNST, they lose the S100 marker, as well as H3K27ME3 is also lost over the course of transformation of the tumor. Now, what is PRC2 and what is its function? PRC2 is a chromatin modifying factor. Now, it has got four components in it. Okay, these are EE2, EZH2, SUS12 and one more. Now, all these four components have their individual functions. Now, PRC2, what it does, it manufactures H3K27ME3, which is a marker of transcriptional repression. So this entire assembly, it forms H3K27ME3. Now this ME3 stands for trimethylation. And what it trimethylates? It trimethylates lysine 27 at H3 position. Okay. Now, this is the marker of transcriptional repression. So, unless the cells are having H3K27ME3, the transcription has been repressed. So, the proliferation potential of the cells have been repressed. Now, once H3K27ME3 is lost, that check goes off and the cells proliferate exponentially to transform into tumor. So these tumors, like whenever the tumor loses H3K27ME3, they have got dysregulated oncogenic signal. Now, what are recent advances in the management of MPNST? So what we have seen is the PRC2 complex, where other components of the PRC2 complex, they undergo mutation in most of the MPNSTs. What remains is EZH2. So EZH2 is it gets relatively overexpressed, and it has been studied by the researchers that EZH2 overexpression can be considered as responsible for evolution of MPNST. So if we target this EZH2, then we can control the MPNSTs, their growth also and their proliferation also. So that is why these EZH2 molecules need to be targeted, which is considered as recent advances in the management of MPNST. Now, this EZH2 is seen in other tumors also, like natural killer or T-cell lymphomas and glioblastoma, carcinoma breast and carcinoma prostate. If we succeed in the management of this EZH2 molecule, then these type of tumors can also be taken care of. These are some of the abbreviations which we have used in the study of molecular pathogenesis of MPNST. These are the references which we have used. With the help of them, we prepared this presentation. Thank you.